the manager about this the other day about having an exit strategy to say, well, we have renewed this contract with this staff. When is the time coming we're actually going to be able to get the bottom down and get the internal team actually working on this? And she doesn't think that actually the next this extension might be about time we have.
Yeah, does that bring back to what did the original contract cost? And are we still part of that nature process? Are we still paying for that? Or is this an additional amount of paying for another organisation to deliver what the previous organisation was doing?
So the original contract was only with Meritech. So we did try and go out with Matrix first. We only paid for the staff who come through Matrix as they work. So we advertised through this MCB when we advertised with the Matrix contract, there was no staff available, so we haven't paid Matrix for any of the housing benefits staff. So then we've gone out, we've procured a new contract with a new company called Meritech, and that's the contract that's been extended. So we are already paying more for the other staff.
That brings me to my final question on about that. Matrix, as it's an authority buying process, do we pay to be part of that group, or is it just pay as when we see they get benefit from it?
Yes, we do. So what happens with the Matrix contract is lots of recruitment consultancy companies, agency companies will register on the Matrix. It's like a system, a Matrix system. And then when we need some new staff, agency staff, we will put a job description, a role brief on there. And all the agencies that are on the Matrix system will send in CVs. What happens is we will pay for the employee through the agency, and we'll pay an uplift to the agency, so we'll pay an agency fee for that.
Yeah, I appreciate that. So it's a case of paying to go, so there's no fee for being part of that club?
No, there isn't, and we actually get a rebate from Matrix, so the Matrix company pays a rebate for the more than we can get our
in between, so that the work that one lot did might have been overtaken by events We've been promised, I think, in the cabinet reports in July, that having making progress with the leisure services review, whatever it was called, was likely to happen. So we've had, I think, something called V4 and B&B and some other people have been in, and now it's somebody else asked to reimagine leisure, though I don't know if the name is reimagine leisure or whether there's the name of a company we haven't got. Angela, I think, to your chair, was at one time looking after this as a portfolio. I don't know where it is now, whether it's still with and Councillor Davies. But it does seem to be running on, and we're paying money out for people to study things, and various consultations with residents that are needed, and we're still paying out people doing studies. And I just wondered where things were, if anyone could help me.
Let's let Shay come back on the
I think just looking at the report, the date is wrong on the left hand side.
Yes.
It does say 27th of 12, 2018. That should be 27th of 12, 2017.
Right, that's
all.
So
we've not got there yet. Yeah. that was probably. I'm not completely certain who it was, but we did last year have some consultancy. I think probably the last one, the BWB consultants, the last ones we were using, and this they expect is their residual payment for that. We haven't been with any consultants since then.
Thank you, Sherry. We spent about £300,000 plus on the reports, and we're still hoping that the cabinet members will tell us what the result of them might be.
I'm not sure we are.
I can say something about it. I believe that there is a report coming to Cabinet before the end of the year.
Thanks a lot.
Jeff.
Yeah. I think, again, this is a bit of a thing I've asked about in the minutes too, about the transformation services. And it would be interesting whether Angela could tell us where in each portfolio the transformation services fit and program fits. But I noticed there's a number of transformation services chairman's in here, which you go through. And I have asked if we could have some sort of report or some sort of oversight of the £40 million savings, whether they're going to be delivered. I believe they've been shifted back a year and so on and so forth. But what have we spent? What have we got? Is it anywhere near what was intended? Have we generated the benefits? What lessons have we learned? Just standard stuff, really, as an assurance board or an audit and risk committee about, given what we spent, did we get the benefits? Are there any lessons we need to learn? But I noticed that there's a few of these procurements for the transformation team in here. Some of them, no doubt, because these are some of the ones that are now being called digital or other things, were probably transformation, but they've been given different titles. So it is a bone I'll keep chewing on, Joe, unless we can at some point have a session that covers it.
Okay, well, Jeff, you're obviously not asking for the reply now. So that will be taken on board. But what was the other point you're reading then? Whether there's perhaps having some special meeting about it? What were you getting at?
No, I think I was not particular. I was taking the various elements of the contract, and it says it's the transformation office, I think, is the procurer. And I was saying that I just think it would be really useful for us as the Audit and Risk Committee to have a look at the transformation programme, which is due to say £40 million, that was where it's got to, and I'm sure I said it to was back a year, where it got to, what are the benefits, what do we spend, what do we get, all that sort of, what are the lessons we've learned, are we going to do things differently going forward?
Shay, you
okay
on that? Yeah, absolutely. I think we did say last time that
I was
on the interview as well to go through the I will absolutely do that. I think if I can just address your previous comment about some of the portfolios and some of the areas, again, I think this report is in the previous council structure, so it's a bit confusing maybe in terms of where it refers to transformation, digital. The next report you'll get will be ordered slightly differently, so it will be within the new council operating structure, which hopefully would address some of those issues and be able to provide a little bit more clarity on that.
Okay.
salary issue being, what can we spend?
That's another. Anything else on this item? In that case, we go on to the next item on the agenda, which is item 6, leader decision referral and further discussion. Just where the line to microphone on the whole feedback. Chair, this is a referral to you from the cabinet member. One thing you ought to know, because that is that this went to the scrutiny committee this time last week, and the scrutiny committee, on seeing this is weighty and there are a number of slides with it, which I thought might be helpful, and a number of talks that we've done, and actually asked for more member briefing on this. So we've agreed to arrange for that, so we'll go through it in more detail at that time. How companies work and how local authority companies are different from ordinary companies, and all of that kind of stuff we can run through using the show today. Not that many jokes, okay, but you know, we'll try our best. What you actually have here, members, is a document that sets out what's being referred to in the council as a blueprint. So the council currently has two companies that it owns. And the question is, how does a company, it's a trading company, and has its own commercial interests, relate to the local authority as a shareholder? So this is now a national standard document or a variation of that, with some slight tweaks for women's purposes, and follows that now adopted national model. There's two points I want to refer you to. But the way that it's been approached is to reflect the Council's own Code of Corporate Governance, which sets out principles by which the Council will run its affairs, and then more detailed information below. There are three principles in this case. The controls and freedoms, so the controls of a company that the Council is a shareholder of and is investing in on behalf of its public, for both a financial and usually social return as well. The relationship, integrity and accountability of that company and the council's role, and then those parties that are involved understanding each other's role, and particularly here, of course, that's the audit committee. So if I refer you to two places, one is page 48. Sets out the score based on some of the questions that members are asking, which is setting out that the principle by which these governance arrangements are set are so that the executive in this case, which is the shareholder representative, can make investment decisions and returns, that the council's overview and scrutiny are able to exercise the decision making. And it's all done in a manner that ensures that companies can both provide full and frank financial and business reporting against their business plans and be open to an appropriate level of scrutiny without fear of commercial confidentiality being breached. So that's been a big topic of conversation with members as to that relationship between a commercial organisation that wants to make quite fast-moving decisions and obviously doesn't want to share too much because that's its trade secrets. Far be it for me to say that would ever happen in the world, but in some councils there are those members who would like to sit, and that's something that's a concern to those companies. I've sometimes got a giggle at that point in some places, but and in the council's position, the council wants to equally assure that actually this is public money that's being invested, and that public money has to be invested to get the right return, otherwise it's not spent right. So the other place I would point you to, which may be helpful, is on page 84. And that's a diagram of the three distinct roles, that in this case members and other officers will play within relationships of the councillors. My apologies for those who've got it printed, not in colour, it's a little faint. But there is a conflict of interest. So there is a conflict between those who are part of the company, who are directors of the company, because they are obliged under company law to always act in the interests of the company, which Councillor Green is what, you know, the conversation we had about Magenta, because you're obliged as a director of that company to act in that company's interests over and above your role as a councillor. That creates a conflict of interest. So you have to choose where they're going to sit. There is the executive role, which is, in this case, is the beyond the budget, is the day-to-day decision maker and the body that holds the companies to account and makes those decisions that are reserved to a shareholder. And then there's overview and scrutiny. And then slightly off to the side of that is the audit committee. Now there is a slight nuance here in that if the council owns quite a large company, then that company will itself have an audit committee under the UK Corporate Code, and therefore actually you won't have really a part to play in that. They will have their own audit committee, they will have their own auditors where possible. We've encouraged them to share the same auditor. Indeed, choice of auditors is, in a wholly owned company is something that is a matter of choice for the council. And will appear in your annual government statements and accounts. But the smaller companies won't necessarily have their own audit company, audits committee, and our auditors and ourselves will take a vote part in that. The last point to pick up really is a partnership. A partnership is different to a company. An LLP, limited liability partnership, is not actually covered under the 89 Act. That's why there's been a big case recently, because it's been challenged, because the law says councils can only own five kinds of companies, and an LLP isn't included on that list. So it was challenged at Haringey when they set up an LLP and said this is unlawful, and the way that partnership was set up is irrelevant. Actually, we've been very careful in setting up our partnership to follow that advice and actually share advice at an early stage. And provided it's set up for the right purposes in the right way, it doesn't need to be incorporated as a company. Even though there is a Rural Growth Company Limited, but that's purely for the purposes so that someone else didn't nick them, which has happened before. That's a process that we'll be going through, but actually for most intents and purposes we will be treating the LLP as though it were a council of a company. We need to account in the same way because that's the easiest way of doing it and the cleanest way to do it. So there's an awful lot of information in there. Happy to take questions, but equally now the scrutiny has asked for a workshop, we will hold it.
Yeah. I want to go back to understanding the time schedule. You've given them successive announcements of various stages, Chris said probably Wirral view in sometime in the spring said it's going there, whatever. So I appreciate that there seems to be more need for greater depth of investigation into legal matters, perhaps since I went to the college launch, which is in March, and there were lots of the great and the good, probably 100 people in the college listening to the cabinet say this is going to be great and it's going to start work and everything else. So I'm coming at it from trying to understand exactly where we're up to and what the time scale is, as to whether things are actually happening or we've still got to sign lots of legal documentation. I did get, thanks to officers, probably about 500 pages of documentation in January, February, which I fought my way through with it some months ago now. So the exact relationships have got a bit dim in my grey matter. So there was always a question of conflict between the aims of the body, whether it's a partnership or a company or whatever, and what the council might have. So we might have a piece of land and partnership might have great aspirations for it. Board members might have different views, and there are all sorts of processes that need to be built in. As a musician, you might know the piece of music written by Ducal, which is called The Sorcerer's Apprentice. So that the sorcerer starts all the kitchen equipment. It was used for that in the cartoon. So everything takes off, gets out of control, and the sorcerer has to come back to stop all the kitchen equipment. I get his wizard's hat on. So you give life to something, it takes off, and somebody has to rein it back in, always that effect. And I just want to know where we're up to, whether this structure that we're talking about, which is set out by Mr. Court in great detail, is one that allows the council to know what's going on.
I've got a sneaking suspicion it's completely the other way.
The temptation to go down various Walt Disney routes is almost unbearable. But I don't resist.
As long as not Pinocchio,
there's no
queen
to be
in setting up any company. So I'm going to separate slightly company stuff from the world of both company stuff, but I will answer your question perhaps all too briefly. In establishing a company or joining a company, buying shares, there's a thing called the shareholders agreement that sets out the relationship between the company and the shareholder. So it's called the shareholders agreement because traditionally it's an agreement between several shareholders as to how they go to manage the company that they own together. But we use the same term even when there's only one shareholder, so you might want to call the management agreement. That sets out those decisions that are reserved to the shareholder. So normally, if you own shares, simply you go along once a year at the annual meeting and you stick your hand up when something's put to general shareholders. Other than that, the company gets on with its own business. With companies such as this, the council usually set out a list of things that says, actually, company, you're empowered to go off and do whatever it is that we've established you to do. But if you want to do any of the following things, you have to come back and ask our permission. The key amongst those is the business plan. So the standard set up and the standard put in here is that a company will be established, with solutions or what have you, and the council will say, we're the shareholder, you're permitted to go and do all the things that are set up here in your business plan. And if you want to go beyond that, then you have to come back and ask our permission. So for example, Ed Central, beginning of the summer, wants to take on a very large extra new contract that's not within his own business plan. It came back to this council and the other council that owns it and says, can we have your permission to enter this large contract? So there is a list of reserved matters. So that's something that will happen on a regular basis and includes things like appointment to auditors. There's usually also a secondary process to that because the council is very often a funder. So the council has lent the company money to go off and do what it wants to do because it's not going to start without any backup capital. So if you've lent it money, you want to know what's happening with that money. And very often the officers of the council, acting as a lender, an officer, will have anything as regularly as a twice-weekly cash flow meeting to see that in the same way that a bank that's lending to a company will want to see those companies records and go through and inquire in great detail. So the company will be left to have that report up by exception and also have those decisions made by a shareholder board. So that's the council of shareholder representative, which would be a cabinet member, and this company the leader acting as that, with a board of officers and advisors to hold the company to account, just to see that that company is doing what it says it's going to be doing and is making council has a contract with its own company, and so there are several hats being worn, which makes it a little good, but so the company, so the council is there as the owner, the council is there as the funder, and the council is also there as a contractor, and trying to do various things at once. And the other party to that, as an observer, is a member from scrutiny, who's there to, as a trusted member, to be part of the very detailed financial commercial information at times, and is trusted by scrutiny to say, you know what, that bit is the bit that we may be interested in scrutiny, and I think we as a committee have to get deeply involved. And it's up to scrutiny as well. So Cheshire West, for example, has this happen once a year. The proper feedback before the adoption of the next annual business plan is to feedback on what's been happening, what's going on. Now, so that's the blueprint. It will follow a very similar format in terms of the role of both the company partnership. The difference here is that very clearly with the role of both partnership, then there are two members who are members of that board, members of the partnership board, who will be acting under instruction from the council. There is a slightly looser arrangement. Those directors still have to act in the interests of the partnership, but it's a slightly looser arrangement than strictly speaking, a company limited by shares. So there is still that separation, and built into that partnership agreement is it's a 50-50 company. There is no chairs casting vote, it's 50-50. So the council retains a significantly greater level of control than it might in other situations, and it's, you know, we'll be acting on each individual development week to see whether the council considers at that point it is worthy of its own investment, because each decision is an investment decision. Now the details, the fine details of the partnership agreement, given that its size, weight and strength, is still subject to some final negotiation. So, as you might hear, many mergers and acquisitions and such agreements, partners announce their intention to join together, and it can take several months, is taking several months, sometimes even longer, for those deals to actually be hammered out in the fine detail that they need to be, to ensure that each side is protecting its own. Sure you we're discussing with lawyers on a regular basis to ensure that the council's interests are protected in developing that agreement.
Well, thank you for that. That's a much clearer account than I think we should say before. Certainly I have heard before. Jeff,
please. That was interesting, so thank you for that, Phil. However, I've got a couple of points. Hopefully, we'll be moving a little bit early about maximum transparency in the work of our audit committee transfers, and we've just been dismissed as well. Well, but I'm concerned about a couple of things. First of all, you did sort of euphemistically describe as people were in several hats. When some of these things I'll discuss. And also, really, thinking about the cabinet and cabinet members who, of course, and the interests of the cabinet and the interests of the company, if they are directors of this LLP, whatever, have to act in the best interest of the company. I know, that we actually have closed cabinet meetings where these sort of things no doubt get discussed. And I would have a bit of a concern around how that would actually operate in those circumstances. Certainly around the transparency agenda also. The other slight issue that I have, and you mentioned you've made some tweaks to work so it can work in a Wirral context. I would like to know what those tweaks are. For you, there might be a tweak. For somebody else, it might be changes you might have to make for it to work in a Wirral context. The other thing, and we have had this discussion, I'll say it again, I strongly believe that parties other than the administration, and we have a single party cabinet, should have a role as in chairing this and the scrutiny committee. That's not, you know, I can understand why the ruling party would take the quasi judicial, because you have a majority of council, but in, and that's what the public have asked for. But in terms of scrutinising, I still strongly believe that that should be all party. And my concern, going back to closed meetings, single parties, whether that be a single party cabinet briefing, whether that be a single party group meeting, I can tell you I would invite the Labour Party to our group meeting, and I can't see why the Labour Party should do the same. But they would actually be inviting the directors of some of these companies, members of the subgroup, and also all the chairs of the various scrutiny committees, including the scrutiny observer, who will be taking, deciding what should come back, what should then be ventilated in an open arena for the council, or people from a different political party, or even the public, to actually have that ventilated. So I think I have a bit of a concern around some of those things, that actually, whether it would be operating in the best interest of the company, the best interest of the council, or the best interests of a particular ruling administration, whether that be a Conservative administration, Labour administration, Lib Dem, Green, call it what you will, I think just as a general principle, that should be open. And just as a sort of slightly tangential view, and maybe it's me getting old and slowing down, but do we actually have a list of all those companies we currently have? So we've got the care company, so we put all the social workers into something with the health service. Is that a company or is it a partnership? We've got it essential, we've talked about, a little putative one. Sometimes I kind of lose track. So would it be possible for us to have a list of all the organisations, current and putative, that fit under this set of governance arrangements that you're describing here? It might well be it's in the slides and I missed it.
I think you have made your point pretty substantially.
And at that, thank you.
Yes.
Chair.
We've got Liz next and then Ron. Chair, shall I? Because there were 4 points there before I lose the touch. I think so. Do you want to wait until?
I'll ask you just to wait until I'm through.
So
I mean, what I would say, if you just wait until I'm finished.
My questions and answers.
Ron does have a very important reason to leave the room.
Yeah, and I would just like to challenge Jeff on something he said, and it's on the integrity of the councillors. Whether I'm in the ruling group or not, I would like in the best interest of the council matters. It's irrelevant. Jeff had closed meetings, but he was in charge of this council, and not been any difference happening now. Until the administration changed, or the administration changed their view, the operating model is the operating model. But I can assure Jeff that I value my integrity and I will exact the best interest of the council wherever I sit.
And just so it's all clear, I don't doubt that for a second, more. But what I am saying is, in terms of public perception and, you know, indeed making those decisions, I think there was something about being, as well as being open, being seen to be open, as well as having a separation of powers, having been seen to have a separation of powers.
Jeff, you have made it very clear indeed.
But I just wanted Ron to be sure I wasn't challenging his intent.
Phil, Joe, I'll respond to this before we ask Liz's question.
I understand that, and I understand Councillor Queen's questions, and actually they're very important.
Is the right answer, Phil?
I'll just stop there.
Yes, yeah, right, let's move on.
I think we can take it.
So, So, 4 points. The first is the various roles of members, and indeed, hopefully, having this code of practice, if it's adopted, helps address that very point, because it sets out actually whose role is what, who does what. Where this all started is that I was engaged by a council 2 or 3 years ago to help sort things out, because like many councils, this one included, over time the council has a good idea and it has a project and it does something, and that may involve an investment or setting up a company, and that's done one way, and then a year or two later there's another project and another company and another company, and this council had several companies all going off on completely their own thing, doing their own way, and it needed sorting out. And that's where this all began, and has led to this national model. Now, in terms of the various hats, as set out in the year, it is very clear that if a member is a director of a company, then duties to that company. That's it. And so there is a hard conflict of interest. It doesn't happen very often, because guess what? The director of a company that the council owns. But once in a while, there will be a difference of agreement between the company's interests and the council. We have tested this out, because of course it wasn't that long ago. We were following this model. Councillor Phil Davies was a director on the company, and Councillor Angela Davies was the councillor who was the shareholder representative. And we were very clear in our advice to keep the two well apart from each other. And there was an extremely hard wall between them, and I can give you that assurance that that was the advice gave. We were party to that, and that's what took place. So there is that distinction. Your second question was over what the tweaks are. Not a lot, which is that in the original version of this, it talked about there being one holding company, and then where the council has many different interests, it will have several subsidiary companies, because there's arguably good tax and other reasons for having a holding company over several subsidiary companies. At the moment, this council doesn't have that kind of setup, because it doesn't have huge trade interests in that way. It doesn't have a huge range of companies, so there's no need for a holding company. So references to a holding company were taken out of the blueprint to avoid confusion. That's it. Absolutely.
If you make some time, you can take me.
Number three was final briefings and scrutiny.
And closed.
Obviously, closed meetings are there for the benefit of the company, because the company is sharing its detailed financial matters. Would have to do so in a closed setting. That does not stop, however, at any point. Scrutiny committee saying, well, we want more information on this, and we want a report from the company, and we want to come before them and be held to account. And indeed, that's one of the suggestions, that there's an annual report from the company.
So just on that point, on page 40, you're saying it's the person selected by the other chairs that make that decision, not the scrutiny. And the closed meetings I was referencing were not the closed meetings of the company. They were closed meetings of any one political party, whatever that might be, in any sets of circumstances, in any organisation controlled the council.
Yeah.
So that's the point I was referencing there, where you're not there to see everyone's wearing the right hat.
And that's the purpose of the shareholder board. That's the closed meeting we're talking about here, the shareholder board, where it's a single council member who is holding the company to account and going into very detailed information about the company. For example, some of the meetings that we've had with companies that have come in to do a presentation to the shareholder have not even handed out papers, because they said this is so sensitive. So it's about how does scrutiny engage with a very regular process of talking to the company. So there is
something that will be used in council taxpayers.
Yes, precisely, and that's why there's that balance. Has to be that balance between protecting the taxpayers' money that's been invested in the company and the interests of that company. And so this is that compromise, as it were, to get to that point. Now that doesn't stop scrutiny saying, at any point, well, we want to have a greater dive into the goings on of the company, both in terms of their books and what they're doing, because the council owns the company. To do that. This is about not setting up a company and then immediately cutting its hamstrings by not allowing it the freedom to go and do the commercial things it needs to do.
Just so this is clear, every company needs to be set up using council taxpayers' money is to achieve an outcome. And the suggestion is the way of achieving that outcome is better backed by a partnership or a company. It is not to say, there's a commercial body, go out and make a load of money. So, no, the issue for us
and that
is...
May be a concept, that may be a discussion about having greater depth in the workshop.
Okay.
Because this is a blueprint for all occasions. The last point, Ralph, you said, is the list of companies the company exists. In terms of active companies, that's quite a short one. There may be a, so for example, whenever in the days of school BFIs, each part of that process will end up setting up its own single purpose vehicle limited company. And I'm sure that it's all over the place. In terms of active companies at the moment, there is Central, Wirral Evolutions, Mersey Maritime Limited, Mersey Maritime Group Limited, four.
So how do we, looks after the Central?
No,
where we transfer the loss and should work out.
That's actually a partnership with another statutory body at all. And wouldn't be coming by this at all, because that is the council either having its staff work alongside NHS colleagues or the transfer staff into or out of the NHS. And the management of that being the committee in common, which means it's not actually a partnership at all, because all of the decision making is still reserved to the council and to the committee of the council. So, not covered by this at all.
Okay. 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 Phil, Liz, did you say you wanted to think of one?
Thank you.
She keeps trying to tell you she's had a question.
Just want to test the water before I get dropped in the boiling water. And it's a bit like a frog, and the frog stays in the water as a hotter. I'd like to make a suggestion, I've asked Mr. McCourt to draw up a report back on the establishment of the mechanism so that the minutes of the shareholder board should be made available for inspection by him.